Harper Audio presents The Spider and the Fly, A Reporter, a Serial Killer, and the Meaning of Murder by Claudia Rowe. Performed by Cassandra Campbell. We look at the world once, in childhood. The rest is memory. Louise Gluck. All stories are stories of survival, provided they are told. Ruth Ozeki. I doubt whether you can even give your telephone number without giving something of yourself. Vladimir Nabokov. Chapter 1. The Weight of Paper. The door to the Pleasant Valley post office pulled against me as if trying to test my resolve. To swing it wide and begin my dutiful march down the white linoleum floor toward mailbox number 1273 required surprising strength. But I did it, as I had all autumn. I trudged past a wall of small steel doors, each little square a portal to someone's story, identical and indistinct, save for what they held inside. Money owed or confessions rendered, forced gestures or pleas unheard. A small universe of private histories locked within those cold metal facings. Boxy and prefab, the post office huddled next to the oldest building in town, on a cracked parking lot surrounded by chain supermarkets. Across the street, a feed store and a garage for heavy equipment repair sat like comfortable old armchairs for the farmers who came into town once a month. But the car dealerships and pizza shops were what blinked loudest to the drivers snaking past in a never-ending line toward somewhere else. Unpleasant Valley, I like to call my middle patch of village between the city of Poughkeepsie and Dutchess County's Hunt Country Estates, reminding myself that I was an interloper here. I'd arrived 5 years before, hired in 1994 as a reporter for the Poughkeepsie Journal to hound the teachers' union and sift school budgets for waste. I quit after 22 months, yet remained in town. I could not say why. To friends, I talked of open fields and the country life. But that was only part of the reason. Something about the city of Poughkeepsie, with its melancholy streets and stubborn boosterism, nagged like a blister. It was November, and I shivered at the stuffy warmth as I walked toward the back of the building. My mailbox was in the last bank of little locked doors, second row from the bottom. A mural painted on the wall opposite showed bonneted farm wives greeting one another in the market square, baskets clutched in the crook of their elbows, implying that Pleasant Valley had once been a bustling village. I slunk past them in disgrace. The only thing I carried was shame, pounds of shame. I was ashamed to be living here, whiling away my 30s. Ashamed to be sleepwalking through life like I was waiting for a wave to pick me up and rush me to the shores of someplace else. Ashamed to have initiated the quest that brought me to the post office every day in hopes of connecting with a figment, a phantom. Week after week, my box remained empty except for a few free circulars, shoved inside like reprimands. I wondered if the mail sorters pitied me. I could glimpse them behind the wall, their stout shoulders working like levers to slot each envelope into its assigned bin, fingers capped with pink rubber thimbles. They surely knew no letter ever came for number 1273, though it might be worse if one did. I cringed at the thought of anyone recognizing the return address. There would be no blur of bills and magazines to camouflage my correspondent. I had rented this box for one person alone. In these final weeks of the 20th century, mail still carried a discreet sensuality. Another person had touched the page you were now holding, had folded and creased it, then slid the rectangle between thumb and index finger, pushed it into an envelope, and licked the gummy backing. That person had pressed the outside flap down and run his finger along the edge. He had held the envelope in his hands, a whisper of the unknown inside, and determined that it should be sent. For this reason, I'd done my best to avoid the postmistress, who jawed with customers when they came by at lunchtime to pick up their packages. But now I was prepared. I'd practiced my pitch, sitting amid the crumpled coffee cups and rotting newspapers in my car. I needed to close my mailbox, cancel my account, and get a refund for the remaining 4 months of my rental, I'd say. I earned near-poverty wages as a stringer for the New York Times, so 100 wasted dollars hurt. None of these flinty folk were likely to question the need to save money. They drove rusty trucks and salt-pocked American cars, though their family names dotted my county road maps. Whatever the manager said, this would be my last visit to the Pleasant Valley post office. I was worn out writing to someone who never wrote back. At the beginning, I'd been almost jaunty about this project, as if it were a game I knew I'd win, as if all I had to do was swing by and collect my prize. That vain assumption dissolved into confusion after a second letter met with continued silence. Now the feeling verged on humiliation. My chest was hollow with the ache of ridiculousness as I slid my key into the lock for one last look. I would pull out a final round of inky coupons, dump them in the overflow garbage can, and be done. But no. Lying inside the narrow steel slot was a single cream-colored envelope, the paper stock textured and substantial. I paused, staring at my name and address scrawled in rounded cursive across the front. Shaking just a bit, I tore it open.
Ms. Claudia Rowe. Greetings. I would like to thank you for your letter, but you know as well as I do that you don't want to be my friend. You want a story. I'm feeling generous, so if you're on the ball, this may be your lucky day. I don't need to make friends with someone that will later betray me. So here is the deal. I want to know everything about you. Everything. For every 10 pages typed, I will answer any 4 questions you have for me, completely and honestly. So 20 pages gets you 8 questions, but 19 only gets you 4. I will answer your questions with the completeness and honesty you answer me. I want to know about your hometown, childhood house, elementary school and high school up through college, your first car, your first kiss, the dress you wore under your graduation gown. I want to know the first time, if ever, you gave a guy a blowjob, the first time you had intercourse, the last time, people you hate at work, affairs, when, if ever, you dyed your hair, the types of computers you have/use. Remember, the more details, the better. This isn't an article for a newspaper, so don't write it like it is. It should have some heart, a spark. If it is cold and indifferent, I may think you're lying. If I think it is a lie, there will be no response. Good evening, Kendall Francois.
The 2 pages of legal-sized paper were covered top to bottom, from the left margin all the way to the edge of the opposite side. The handwriting was concentrated, childlike, but each word had been carefully formed, and there were no cross-outs or squeezed-in afterthoughts. It suggested someone working with great determination and control. I read the letter once, standing in the back of the post office, then drove home, shoved it under a stack of books, and did not touch it again for 2 weeks. Chapter 2. 99 Fulton Avenue. The first rule of reporting is that the writer is never the story. So my tale, by definition, is not journalism. But that is where it began. The desk where I stashed Kendall's letter was an old office table with steel legs and a polyurethane top made to look like wood. My landlord had hauled it out of his garage as a loaner. I lived above the garage, in a treehouse apartment with my boyfriend, Derek, the person from whom I was hiding this envelope. A curious deception, as Derek had been the one to goad me into covering this story to begin with. Every night, he came home from reporting environmental news at the Journal, grousing about the paper's refusal to run anything longer than a brief after two women had vanished. Then three, then four, and still hardly a word. I had left the newsroom by then, and I saw their inky faces on missing person flyers taped to storefronts and lampposts, smudged by weather and time, their gazes defiant, distant, drugged. But not until the summer of 1998, after seven women had disappeared, did I pick up the phone. My first call went to Marguerite Marsh, because of all the missing women, her daughter looked the most approachable. Marguerite's voice was thin and weary as she spoke to me from her home in Schenectady, an hour's drive north. But she answered all of my indelicate questions about Catherine, her hobbies and sports teams, favorite songs and unrealized promise. I nudged toward the relationship between mother and daughter, street life and addiction. Being a reporter allowed you to do such things, to barge into strangers' lives with authority, as if you had the right. This always felt like fraud to me, but victims bowed to it every time. Most were already accustomed to intrusion, from social service agencies and court personnel, hospitals and police. And if not exactly comfortable with the process, they acquiesced. After Marguerite, I called Pat Barone, mother of Gina, and James DeSalvo, brother of Kathleen Hurley. I called boyfriends and detectives, and finally, I called an editor at the Times.
"What's going on up there?" he asked amiably.
I'd just finished 9 months of babysitting a libel trial notable for one lawyer who demonstrated part of his argument by lying on the courtroom floor, writhing. After that came a domestic violence case that spurred our district attorney to seek the death penalty. My next story concerned a religious cult in the mountains above Woodstock. I was becoming a reliable source of country quirk for the Metro desk. They were always happy to hear from me. "I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not sure there is a story. Women keep being reported missing in Poughkeepsie. A lot of women. I've made a few calls. But it's been going on for a couple of years."
"Keep digging," said the editor. "And check back with me when you've got more."
I became a reporter because I thought it would teach me to write. Journalism would instill discipline, which I lacked. It would force me to structure my rambling attempts to make sense of the world. It would help me develop focus and clarity, pin down what was real. In that area, I had problems. Everything felt meaningful. The intuited even more than the proven. The rumored as much as the visible. And I cared too much about all of it. Possessed of a lacerating anger that attached itself to every story. I never tried to untangle the genesis of this sensitivity. Instead, I told myself the fire would lend power and energy to my work. Which it had. In my first newspaper job, I arrived at my desk by 6 a.m. and spent weekends off tracking delinquents. I ran down a teenager who'd scrawled swastikas outside a string of Jewish businesses in the Bronx and came up with a portrait of a metalhead dropout that crowned me the New York Press Association's rookie reporter of 1992. I talked my way into legal archives where I had no business, and uncovered the dissolute past of a city school board member who'd been the getaway driver for a failed teacher assassination plot. All of it chasing answers to the question I never spoke aloud.
"You want to know what makes people do the things they do? You want to understand motivation?"
said my first editor, cutting to the heart of the matter.
"Cover schools."
No pitch could have hit harder. Whether they were in classrooms or jail cells or standing on street corners, I ran down the misbegotten and reviled to measure the distance between us and find my way toward comprehension, if not forgiveness. I was not much good at forgiving. But journalism at least allowed me to interview and dissect my fears, flattening human mystery into 20 inches of type. The instant I stepped off the train in Poughkeepsie's sooty old railroad station to start my second newspaper job, I knew I'd made a mistake. The Poughkeepsie Journal had hired me as its education writer, and at the time, being wanted meant more than who was asking, so I'd ignored the tight flutter of foreboding in my throat, boxed up my dishes and furniture, and joined a dozen other would-be writers in a grimy newsroom where rainwater leaked from the ceiling. We pecked at our keyboards, churning out stubbornly cheery tales from the center of a dead-end town, and focused the bulk of our coverage on the suburbs. Crime reports came on press releases faxed by the police department.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.